Halston. Who was it? Halston. Oh, Joe Halston. Who said that? Who said that? I'm not going to attack you or anything like that. I'm just curious. Are there any Halston fans here?
Yeah!
Yes, yes. Halston is a labor of love by Adam Green, Joe Lynch, and everybody involved. You've seen it, sitcom had a couple of seasons on the internet, and not on the internet, but what was it on?
Fear Net,
whatever that was. But and it was just awesome, a pure labor of love. Nobody made a dime doing it. Oh, we had a hell of a time doing it. And I get to play Lance Rocket, this guy who's in a Van Halen tribute band called Diver Down. And like Klinger from the old MASH TV shows, he walks around, he manages a cable station, and he walks around in full-on 80s regalia. You know, the spandex, the makeup, everything, full-on. So now when they asked me to play this part, I said, this is awesome. I'm going to get to make fun of every 80s guy I ever despised. Every 80s guy. So I picked out my pocket most basic 80s outfit. Striped spandex pants, Ricky's going on with us. Okay, leather vest, studded bracelets. I mean, the cheapest, the most basic, the lamest ass 80s metal gear I could find. And I put it all on and went, this is going to be great, man. And I'm walking to the set, and some grip from another TV show goes, yo, Dee, still rocking the outfit.
Listen, I love to tell you, I'm here because my mom was such a fan.
but yeah, no. Not a fan of Dee Snider's work at all. Proudest moment was when I wrote a song that Celine Dion recorded. Yes. Don't say one fucking bad word about Celine, she bought my house. Okay. And, Saints, you know, the doorbell actually plays the melody of the song. No, and she, but I said metal and rock has always been that place where I could let my emotions go. Whatever they were, especially anger and frustration and sorrow and depression and all that stuff. And I'm here just because I gotta let it out somehow. So, you know, I'm going through the shows of my life, letting these feelings out, and then go back and work in the studio and deal with my mom's passing. So I'm in the studio, coming to the Jamie point, and I'm singing this song called I'm Ready. And the song itself is just about facing mortality. But I'm singing this line in the song, and it goes, death brings a sorrow no one can heal. Love leaves a memory no one can steal. And I'm singing it over and over, and suddenly, and Jamie wasn't there, and Nikki Belmore, the producer, the engineer was working with me. I stopped and I said, is that line about my mom? And he said, yeah, Jamie wrote that for you, for your mom, for you, for your mom. Like he saw what I was going through and wrote a song that would express the feelings that I couldn't express. So he got me like nobody's got me ever. And this record is as heartfelt and genuine, it couldn't be more. So when you hear it, you'll know what I'm talking about. But thank you, Jamie Chasta, for that. Yeah, right there.
I'm a huge fan, grew up child of the 80s, grew up
Don't like the clown.
One thing that always inspired me throughout your whole career had been the PMRC trial. Even in high school, I did a whole thesis about the trial, how it affects music today and all that. And in your opinion, over 3 years later, how do you think it still affects artists today and you still have the same things as it did 3 years ago?
Well, first of all, thank you for appreciating that. And the Senate hearings in the 80s, for those who don't know, there was this group of Washington Wives who wanted to get records rated, Ricky remembers, and they wanted to censor rock and roll, and I went to Washington with Frank Zappa and John Denver, testified. In defense of rock and roll and try to show that, look, it's censorship. It's First Amendment, baby. It's our right to freedom of speech. And nobody should be censoring art. Nobody should be telling us what we can or cannot hear. And I went there and fought Frank, myself, John Denver. We all spoke eloquently. We all made our points. We all scored big that day. But the recording industry, before we even got there, turned out had agreed to the warning parental advisory sticker. It was a done deal. And I remember being with Frank in the back area, going, why are we, they told us when we got there that the recording industry had agreed to the sticker already. So we're like, well, what the fuck are we doing here? You know? It was a moot point there. We tried to make the point, but show the problems with censorship and show what's wrong. And censorship is an ongoing thing. It's constantly a battle. We constantly have to fight to defend our rights and our freedoms. This said, I feel slightly bad for the conservatives of the world because they started with the line way back here somewhere and they were holding their ground and then we go, oh, this is over here. So they moved the line over and go, well, you can't go any further than that. And then we go, this step over here. And as fate is keep pushing it back, and the shit that we get to do today is mind-blowing. At this point, they're just like, just don't pull your cock out, okay? They're just looking for anything. Okay, I'm just going over here. And so, I actually feel a little sorry for her, but it is just an ongoing struggle, because at the end of the day, it's freedom of speech. At the end of the day, it's freedom of art, okay? And we don't need anybody telling us what we can or cannot see. It's the job of the parents to do with their kids, not that the government is not babysitters. They're not our babysitters. All right, so. Keep it up. Over there. Oh, you went this way. Okay, come to your desk.
Hey, how are
you? I'm good, man.
I was wondering, when I first saw Strangeland, it was really one of the first horror movies I ever watched. I was wondering, what was the concept when you were coming up with the ideas of this movie on the character and the cast, and how, what was like the approach going into the film?
With Strangeland, I literally wanted to reinvent the game. I literally wanted to change the game. And, well, there's multiple stages of Strangeland, and it's worth mentioning since this is a horror convention. First of all, I decided to write a horror movie when I was watching Leprechaun. Now, and that was my inspiration, and I was literally screaming at the TV, "It's a leprechaun! Step on it!" and the movie's over. Okay, what are we gonna do now? Oh, there's a doll, look at the doll, let's get him next. So I felt at that point with Chucky and the leprechaun, it was just, what the fuck happened to damn horror movies? I said, I gotta do something, I gotta create something. And I wrote a script, I wrote the original Strangeland script, but it was a pretty straight ahead, traditional slasher film, but with a real scary guy. And I showed it, I was good friends with Tom Savini, and I said, Tom, take a look at my script, man. I think you're gonna love this. And I thought, Tom goes with Dee, I read your script. And I said, what do you think? He says, it sucks. If you met Tom, you know he's very capable of being that honest. But that's a friend. Okay, because in this world, everybody will yes you to death, but a few people will tell you the truth. And come from Tom Savini, I know it must really suck. And but he said to me, and if you come out to see me, I'll tell you why. So, went to Pittsburgh, and where Tom lives, and I spent the night, the long day and night, I'll tell you about my night with Tom, in a second, and he told me exactly what was why it was, he said it was derivative. It was the same thing, you haven't done anything new. And he was right, the script was completely derivative. Okay, little side story, Tom Savini. So I'm hanging out with Tom in his house. It's like 3 o'clock in the morning, and he goes, oh, dude, I gotta get something from my shop. And Tom Savini's special effects makeup school and shop is literally blocks from his house. So he goes, come on. So we're walking to a shop at 3 o'clock in the morning, in Pittsburgh, streets are empty. We get to the shop, goes there and he goes, oh yeah, it's up in the attic. Alright, okay, it's in the attic, we're in the attic. So we go upstairs, Tom flicks the switch on, and the lights don't work. Sure, here's a flashlight. Okay, so now we're walking through Tom Savini's special effects makeup attic at 3 o'clock in the morning. And we're looking for something that Tom has to have at 3 o'clock in the morning. And there's something, there's body parts and intestines. And we're going through, oh, there it is. And he gets a severed head. And he goes, here, hold this for me. So now we're walking through the streets of Pittsburgh at 3 o'clock in the morning, carrying a severed head. And I'm still not getting it. He's fucking with me. And I'm like, okay, Tom's meeting, you severed head. That's what we're talking about. Put my mind.